So welcome to this panel session on education. So we are very glad to have with us a nice panel to discuss about training future AI experts. So Nicolas Vayatis is also the director of the master program MVA, Mathematics, Vision and Learning, which trains more than 150 students per year. Natalie has also worked for OpenClassrooms, which delivers online training. And we have also Steve, who is from Future Lab. And Future Lab is a startup tech incubator in NYA. And Sébastien, who just spoke previously. So the topic of training is very important, and it was discussed yesterday with Cédric Villani, who highlight how training is crucial, and many points were raised, such as the fact that it seems that many people are educated about deep learning and ML with machine learning meetups, with US MOOCs. So they also discuss the relationship with the ecosystem, company, industry, and academia. So there are many points to discuss. So first, I think that we can start with a classical observation that there is a mismatch between offer and demand. And so there is a need to build a strong cursus, both at the master and PhD levels, to feed both the public and private sectors. So maybe I'm going to ask Nicolas first what I thought about it, what can we do in France, and so on.
Yes, I confirm there is this mismatch between offer and demand. It's a demand coming from both companies but also students. So in our program in École Normale Supérieure, we have more than double the number of incoming students to this program in less than 5 years. So I think we are already beyond the equilibrium point because our institutions are not prepared to deal with so many students. At the same time, there is a request for massification even more the training in this in topics like data science and artificial intelligence. So for me, there are maybe two directions. Well, first of all, it's to determine whether we have to answer the needs coming from the internet industry or the needs of the rest of the industry, more traditional industry, healthcare applications, education, and maybe it's not exactly the same positioning. So maybe we have a chance to discuss this a bit further, but I think this is the important question.
So maybe you would like to react on this?
We're definitely seeing the same phenomenon in Canada, where obviously, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, we have a lot of talent because professors have been teaching for a long time students, but the private sector demand obviously is putting a lot of pressure on that. You know, as I mentioned a few minutes ago about looking back at 1995-96, I think we can be inspired. We can inspire ourselves by what happened when the web arrived, when we needed HTML coders. I'm not going to say AI is as simple as HTML, though. And then the mobile wave around 2007-2008, where there was a lack of iOS engineers. And so it's going to be a question of, yes, training people formally in universities, but making sure professors stay in universities to train students as well, and make sure professors are incentivized to continue doing research on one side. And then obviously the private sector will need to step up and train their own employees. We have no choice. I mean, we'll need to level up even internally. And then I think the emergence of online training will probably help as well.
Yes, so maybe we can...
Since the words online training have been pronounced, I'm a former director of partnerships at OpenClassrooms, and in this capacity, we launched 3 full-fledged degrees in data science. So if this question would have asked to me last year, what exists in France online in terms of training for machine learning, for data science, I would have said, hélas, rien, nothing. But today, we have a full offer. We have data analyst with NSAE, whom you know is one of the good schools in the area. We have data scientist, which has lots of modules on machine learning, supervised and unsupervised with Centrale Supélec. And in fact, Chloé Agathe, who just spoke here, is one of the teachers on the course. So it's really the quality of a very high level. And one course for data architect also with Centrale Supélec. So, and I will give you some of the, and I'm not speaking about MOOCs, you know, very small courses, quite often they're directed to general public. These are full-fledged online degrees with courses, with practical projects, quite serious practical projects that the students might take several weeks to complete, with personalized accompaniment if you want it, with the exam at the end. And I will give you some numbers. I cannot reveal the numbers of a general number of students for this course, but just two numbers. Course for data scientists was launched in February 2017. Within one week, we had 1,000 people that took a placement test, which was quite complex. I mean, you need to know, you have to get good knowledge of probability and good level of programming, but 1,000 people in France, in French, took this placement test. And the course started in February, and in June, we received an message from one of our students. The course is not complete yet, but he already received a job offer. So he's just did one module of the course, maybe one and a half, and he was already employed as a data scientist. So there is a demand, and online learning can definitely meet this demand.
Yes, I guess online learning is also a way to encourage raising awareness among large people and the community, and not only future data scientists or AI experts, but also people from management, business, and so on, because there is a need for education at all the levels. So it can be a way, maybe not the only way. We were also thinking about school awareness in schools, so these are ways to do. So maybe I would like now to have more input about the relationship between academia, industry, and training, and maybe with your experience, Steve, because yesterday we just say with Cédric Villani, they were saying that professors were not allowed to work simultaneously in France, in company, and at university. So this was a problem, but maybe not only. So
yeah, and so I think there's two things that I want to cover, and one is sort of the other side, because I think there's a lot of discussions about how we can educate students, but I think there's also a big mismatch between the expectations of a student who's studying artificial intelligence, right? We have this illusion that, you know, if you take a year of AI classes, you're going to be you're going to get $1 million a year salary because you're all of a sudden you're a computer vision expert. And I think what most people don't realize is, you know, the head of AI for Uber or for Google, like these are people who have been studying computer vision for 10 years and 15 years, who've been immersed in the industry when nobody thought it was a good thing to do. So I think there's this illusion that exists that, you know, that somebody who transitioned into the AI industry as a student is all of a sudden going to get paid some major salary. And the reality is, there's a great company in New York called X.AI, who I think they have something like 120 AI trainers, which means an AI expert sits there and labels data all day, which is not what you expect to do if you study AI. So I think there's a big mismatch between the actual jobs that are being filled by the experts and sort of the expectations of the students. I think to the question that you asked, one of the reasons that this problem has been exacerbated over the last couple of years is a lot of the experts in the industry, the faculty members that are doing research, have been poached by the large companies, right? You look at the top talent, Fei-Fei has been poached by Google, Yann LeCun, At NYU, every day we try to find ways that we can clone him. Just because, you know, he spends the majority of his time at Facebook. You look at, you know, Canada, ElementAI. Josse was the last one who was independent, and now he's a part of ElementAI. You have all these, you know, all these godfathers of AI and all the experts in AI are working in industry. So you have this gap, I think, that's starting to open between the ability for schools to teach students the skills they need to get a job and the expectations of companies when they're hiring talent. So I think there's going to be a flood of low-level AI expertise. So again, data labeling, data wrangling, whatever you want to call it. And you're going to have the high end of, you know, the researchers like Jan and others. And there's going to be a gap in the middle of people who are not going to get paid the same sort of level as Jan and the others, but are still vastly important to the Googles of the world. And we're going to have a shortage of those kinds of people because there's no one there to train them.
Yes, I guess it's very difficult also at the university level to find people to train. So we have difficulties to find teachers on specific topics. So maybe a solution is to hire people from companies. This can be also something that is done, I guess.
I think it would be wise for companies, startups, and large enterprises alike to dedicate the time of some of their AI experts to go back and train and educate the future workforce. You know, there's a great analogy that I use from World War II, where one of the things that the United States military did well—not many things, but one thing that they did well—was they took their best pilots and they sent them back to train the future pilots. And there was, you know, the war in, you know, in Japan, for example, they put their best pilots and they made them fly. So I think that sort of mentality of taking the best talent and not deploying it necessarily, but having to come back and train the workforce is important. I think it would be wise for startups and enterprise alike to dedicate, you know, like Google says you can work 20% of your time on anything you want. They should teach. The 20% should be spent on teaching. So I think that's very, very important for them to do.
So maybe I would like to discuss about what we need to teach as well, because we say, okay, we need to teach and to train more students, but there are always the topics of what is legal, about privacy, ethics. So I know that, again, in Canada, there is a Master of Data Science that has been created at the University of British Columbia by Jenny Bryans and people are really involved in the R community, so that's why I know them. And in this master, so there are a lot of data descriptive, description visualization, machine learning, data science framework, causality and causal inference as well, but also a whole lecture on legal aspects. And they have case studies to know what is legal or not. So this is something that is often discussed, but I'm not sure in France it's something that we are doing really.
Yes, I think it's a sensitive question because there's always the fear that it may also, it can be, if you think too much about, legal aspects, this might block, in some sense, the innovation. But of course, you have to take into account. So the question is by whom? And maybe people on the side of studies in law should be probably more equipped with technical education in order to really understand what are the main questions that are raised by these technologies. I'm not sure that it's, of course, engineers and designers of this kind of system should have some awareness, but I'm not sure it should take too much time in their program. So I think this is maybe one question. I think it's a general question of acceptability. And if we don't have a faster development of these technologies today, at least in Europe, it's because there is this issue of acceptability. And this should be worked both on the ethical and legal point of view, but also from, the field expert's point of view. So maybe this also answers to the question of how or what kind of content we should bring to the students, to AI students, is also to develop some specific field expertise. So maybe bring the AI contents lower in the education program in undergrad, but also in high school and college. Because I think, in fact, there should be, I mean, the sizing of AI training programs should be just as the other ones. There's no reason why it should be so massive. But at the same time, you should have strong AI education in all possible sciences or fields of expertise. So that would be a recommendation to design maybe future education programs at all possible levels.
I think, Julie, your point is right. In fact, when we work with large companies, we have a need for a skill set of industrializing algorithms. So there's a difference between just taking a paper that's been published and then making it industry grade within a bank, for example. And so not only is that talent rare, because you actually need to have implemented it in a work environment, in a commercial environment. So, and it ties back into this whole necessity of having entrepreneurs as well, like entrepreneurship classes and things like that. But obviously that's a whole different topic from a training point of view. But in order for a private sector to emerge, you need the fundamental research, you need the applied research, you also need the ability to deploy in commercial environments, plus you need the ability to be business people as well.
Perhaps I would add what today is taught online in France and perhaps more general in Europe in the matter of AI. Well, we all agree here that AI is actually a very large spectrum. I mean, chatbots is AI and self-driving cars is AI. So, and I compiled the sort of three top trainings in the area. Well, number one obviously goes to the courses I launched at Open Classrooms, the 3 degrees in data science. And also, Open Classroom has several courses, initiation to robotics, actually for children, and course for general public about how data science and machine learning transforms daily life of companies. So number two, there is a small startup which is called Kokoroe, a French startup. Kokoroe is a Japanese word, means knowledge. And they have two very interesting courses online, fully online in AI. There is one on chatbots. It's actually done by data scientist at Dataiku. And this is exactly an example of someone who is working for a company but teaches also his skill. And another is a course on artificial intelligence done by Vincent Boucher, who is from Montreal. So this is number two. And then France Université Numérique, although they do not have a comprehensive offer in AI, there are very good courses that prepare you. There are courses in data science by INRIA. There are courses in robotics, I think, by INRIA. And also there is a very useful course which is called Socle Mathématique. Is like a remedial mathematics, which is prerequisite for anyone who wants to do data science or AI.
Okay, so maybe Steve, yes.
Very, very briefly, the one thing I want to add is I really want us to, as an industry, want to avoid what at least was a big problem in New York when all these dev shops started to open, you know, different schools to teach everyone front-end design and back-end design. And what they created was this robust pool of generalists who were not very good at doing anything well. So, you know, when our companies, we have about 50 companies in our portfolio at any given time, went to these schools to hire talent, they hired zero people. Because if you hire somebody who's very generalist and very very young, well, maybe not young, but very very new at what they're doing, it's going to take the startup a tremendous amount of their own time and energy to train them into doing what they need to do. So I think one of the things that we need to consider is how do we not just train AI people, but how do we train AI specialists? And I think one of the things we need to start doing is identify what are the specialties that we need over the next, you know, 2, 3, 5 years and focus on training AI specialists in those fields.
So thank you very much. So because time is flying by, I would just like to conclude with maybe a small word from Nicolas, if you'd like, on training future experts.
Yeah. There's a question is to know whether we need so many data scientists and AI experts. because maybe it's a transition point where the tools are not mature yet. So maybe a message I could pass is that there is a need, at least in France, I think there are some good initiatives to support open source and reproducible research, because it's a way to shorten the time for transfer technology and to standardize the products of the scientific community. So maybe an effort could be put at this particular question, and then maybe it would solve up to some point the increasing need for data scientists.
Okay, so I guess we need to stop. So I would like to thank you very much, and thank you.